My name is Zachary Goldman. I'm the executive director of the Center on Law and Security here at NYU Law School. And it's really an extraordinary pleasure to close out the academic year with an evening like this and with guests like this. The discussion is about the new national security order. Somebody killed the lights. Maybe it was the Chinese. Anyway. In addition to our esteemed faculty director, Sam Raskoff, we've got four really incredible guests to help sort through what's going on in the world. Immediately to Sam's left is a woman we're extraordinarily proud to call a distinguished fellow here at NYU Law School, Lisa Monaco, who joined us in February from the White House, where she was assistant to the president for Homeland Security and Counterterrorism, which was really just the culmination of an extraordinary career in national security law, and with whom I'm very excited to be teaching in the fall. And for those students in the class, sign up now. Next to Lisa is Colin Call, who is teaching now at Georgetown Law School. And also capped off an extraordinary public service career as the national security advisor to Vice President Biden toward the end of the Obama administration, but has long experience working on defense and security issues and on Middle East related issues. David Cohen just stepped down in January as deputy director of the CIA. Before that, I had the honor to serve with him at the Treasury Department, where he was first the assistant and then the undersecretary for terrorism and financial intelligence in charge of our sanctions and counterterrorism financing policy, counter-illicit finance policy more broadly. And to his left, Wally Adeyemo, with whom I also had the honor to serve at the Treasury Department, is now at the Center for Strategic and International Studies in Washington, having served most recently as the Deputy National Security Advisor for International Economic Affairs, and who's done some extraordinary work before that at the White House and the Treasury Department. So we really have an incredible group of guests this evening. And before I turn it over to Sam, please just join me in thanking and welcoming them.
Thank you, Zach. Welcome, everyone. Delighted to be here for what promises to be a great conversation. So we are approximately, someone will set me straight here, I'm sure, we are approximately 100 days into the Trump administration.
97,
thank you.
Who's counting?
And here's what we're not going to do this evening. What we're not going to do is we're not going to issue a report card to the president and purport to assess on some metric how well he and his administration is faring. I mean, by the by, I'm sure we'll have a lot to say about his performance thus far, but I think it would be an impoverished conversation if all we did was do the equivalent of assign a grade. But instead, what I thought we would do is meditate on where we've come to 97 days into this administration, and more importantly, what those 97 days tell us about the prospects of American foreign policy and national security decision-making over the course of the upcoming months and years. And inevitably, to do so, we will have to look backward, not just to the past 3 months, but also to the last decade, indeed probably decades, to establish some kind of baseline for where we got to and where we're going. So I thought what we would do is do this in stages. If you will, in the first round of questions that I'll pose to our panelists, we'll talk about some of the hot spots around the world. Maybe we would then turn in a second round of questions to some of the most salient relationships that the United States has across the globe and to think about where those relationships have come to rest as of now. And finally, to turn in a third round of conversation to some larger themes that drive our foreign policy and national security decision making, with an expectation that we will do all of that in roughly 50 minutes, give or take, and there was light. And we would then use the balance of our time to exchange in our traditional high-minded, intellectually serious question and answer.
And the first 50 are gonna not be
high-minded. The first 50 will be goofy, and offbeat, and then we'll turn to the serious stuff when the audience becomes engaged. So without further ado, Lisa, the president obviously campaigned in no small measure on a counterterrorism platform, implicit and explicit in a lot of what he said, and maybe in some of what he's done over the last 3 months, has been a view about how America ought to pursue its counterterrorism agenda vis-a-vis ISIS in the Middle East, maybe around the world in particular. I wonder if you could give us some sense of what is the United States' outlook or view or strategy with respect to ISIS, and what is its counterterrorism policy more broadly?
Well, thanks very much, Zach. I'm sorry, Sam.
It's all right. We're the same. Zach. Yeah, both.
First, I was glad to hear that we're going to meditate, because I think we all need to take a moment. And I also want to thank you and Zach and the entire team at the Center and more broadly at NYU for welcoming me here and obviously my former colleagues. It's a treat for me to be here at NYU after my time in government. It's really a terrific community and I really feel privileged to be here. I also should say I'm very thankful to my former colleagues. All of the gentlemen up here are those with whom I served for the last many years in government, and most specifically for the last 4 years in the Obama administration. And I can say this is the first meeting that I've been to that I've actually been on time. They will attest. See, that was knowing laughter from the group here, because they used to have to come to the meetings that I would hold in the Situation Room at the White House, and I was unfailingly late, so they are very kind to indulge me and indulge all of us with their presence. So to your question, Sam, what is the administration's counterterrorism policy? Look, I think it remains a significant set of open questions. Why do I say that? There has been a lot of discussion of late that President Trump in particular and the administration more broadly may be engaged in a kind of reversion to the mainstream when it comes to foreign policy. That meme has gotten started a little bit because of some reversals that President Trump has engaged in vis-a-vis NATO, Syria to some extent, China and Russia, and I'm sure we'll get into all of that as we talk. So the question emerges for me, as somebody who has spent the better part of the last decade focused on counterterrorism and homeland security, is that trend going to continue when it comes to counterterrorism policy? And I think the question really remains to be answered, because aside from President Trump's pledges on the campaign trail to, quote, end ISIS and to eradicate radical Islam, we frankly haven't seen, we don't know. The administration has not discussed publicly or proclaimed publicly what's going to be its counterterrorism strategy, and frankly, its strategy against ISIS beyond the battlefields in Iraq and Syria, and most recently in Afghanistan. We know that there are stepped-up strikes being taken in Iraq and Syria. That, frankly, is fully in line and looks to be, from me and my colleagues will have more to say on this, to be a continuation, as far as it goes with the campaign against ISIS in Iraq and Syria, of the strategy laid out and pursued by President Obama and his national security team. So we know in that space, it's kind of a steady as she goes with an increase in some of the military strikes. For my mind, that's all to the good when it comes to shrinking the ISIS caliphate or their so-called caliphate, their self-proclaimed state in Iraq and Syria, and pushing them back from what has made it a unique counterterrorism challenge, which is to take and hold ground in Iraq and Syria. But it has had many other manifestations, two of which I'll mention, which is their ability to deploy foreign fighters to Europe, most specifically, as we've seen, to devastating and horrifying effect in Paris, Brussels, and other places. But most uniquely, I think, and what distinguishes it in my mind as somebody focused on homeland security, has been its ability, ISIS's ability, to exploit social media to recruit and radicalize young people, including young people here in the United States, and to inspire them to violence. And thus far, I think we have seen precious little from the administration about what it's going to do to address the foreign fighter travel to Europe and being an e-ticket away from the United States, and what it's going to do vis-a-vis the messaging, ISIS's vile messaging, and what it's going to do to counter that. I'll say, make two last points. On the foreign fighter piece, the Obama administration focused acutely, particularly after the attacks in Paris, on trying to build our European partners' capability to identify terrorists in their midst, using a lot of the same techniques and tools that we, frankly, in the United States have benefited from since 9/11. And we made a big push to work cooperatively with our European partners on that score. So is the Trump administration going to continue that? That remains an open question, and some of the rhetoric about Europe, I think, would tend to make one slightly skeptical about that, but we'll see. With respect to counter-messaging, we haven't seen a strategy from the Trump administration on that score. One data point we do have is the immigration and travel ban that the Trump administration issued in its first month and its successor, which from my perspective and that of, frankly, a set of bipartisan national security experts, that ban and that executive order in and of itself runs headlong in support of and feeds into ISIS's recruiting narrative rather than countering it. And I say that because it feeds into and supports the ISIS strategy and recruitment narrative that the West and the United States is in a war against Islam. So far from having a strategy to counter ISIS messaging, I think we've seen at least one step that feeds it. So that, I think, is some of the things I see on the horizon and where I see a whole set of open questions.
Thank you very much, Lisa. David, let me turn to North Korea, where there's been a tremendous amount of, for lack of a better term, saber rattling, I guess, over the last couple of days and weeks now. And I wonder whether, with respect to North Korea and whatever's been going on there or around that issue set, whether you would share Lisa's view or Lisa's kind of term that there's been some kind of reversion to the mean, or it's been something like business as usual, or whether there's something recognizably different going on there. And if so, where do you assess that the issue is going to be headed?
So let me also begin by thanking you, Sam and Zach, for inviting me here and for inviting me to be on the board of advisors here. I'm looking forward to doing it. I have, as I was just saying before we began, I am almost entirely unemployed right now. My only employment, to the extent it exists, is being an advisor here. So it's a good thing. Doesn't pay very well, but it's a good thing. It is great to have this sort of deputies committee meeting in the open. You'll be.
Somebody has to hold deputies committee meetings.
Exactly. and this may be this may be more coherent than most deputies committee meetings, but we'll see. North Korea. So I do think that the administration's current policy, which is essentially what they've described as a policy of maximum pressure, really is the same policy that we were pursuing previously with sort of more noise around it, is the way I would describe it. Fundamentally, Sean Spicer said this from the podium yesterday, the objective of the maximum pressure strategy is to create a dynamic where we can either in a bilateral fashion or with our partners enter into a negotiation with Kim Jong-un to initially freeze and then eventually roll back his nuclear program and his ballistic missile program. That is not far different from what was being pursued previously. I do think this administration is doing something somewhat differently from what we were doing, and that is mostly around the intensity of the effort to increase the pressure to get into this negotiation. And they're doing it, as we've seen in the last several weeks, I think in a way that is potentially most dangerous, and that is through military signaling, by sending the carrier strike group eventually to North Korea, by having the ballistic missile submarine, the Michigan, dock in South Korea, and to do so in a very public way and for it to be publicized. And of course, through the various statements of the president on Twitter and elsewhere, sort of being quite torqued up in the language about not tolerating North Korean missile tests, North Korean nuclear tests. The reason that that is potentially the most dangerous way to increase the pressure is that what Kim Jong-un fears most is that the United States will attack. He lives in a world, and in his worldview is one in which we are still at war. There's an armistice, but there's not a peace treaty ending the Korean War. He thinks and is convinced that at some point the United States is going to come in and try and, through military means, engage in regime change. As we signal with military pressure that we are, from his perspective, preparing ourselves to at least be in a position to engage in a military strike, that can lead to an escalatory cycle where he's feeling that he's about to be attacked and he will move first. Their doctrine is to strike first and not be the recipient of the first strike. And so what the administration is doing is trying to create this pressure, but doing it in a way that is, I think, potentially quite destabilizing. The other way to create pressure, and I'm happy to go into this at greater length, but I will refrain from now, is to work more on the economic pressure, the financial pressure side. There is much more that we can do. It is a myth that North Korea is sanctioned out. There are a number of things that we can do to sort of squeeze North Korea in a way that will really put pressure, I think, particularly where we need to put pressure, which is on the seam between Kim Jong-un and the Pyongyang elite, the military, the intelligence, and the party elite in Pyongyang, to play on that seam and try and split them from Kim Jong-un, to create the dynamic, rather, where he feels he needs to begin a negotiation. I think we can, we ought to be focused on that. So I guess the last point I would make on North Korea is that in the transition from our administration to the Trump administration, this was highlighted, I think, as the number one most urgent, most important national security issue that the Trump administration needs to deal with, I think, and rightly so. It is not a crisis, however. And one of the things that I am concerned about is that we are today manufacturing a crisis with North Korea in a situation where we don't know what our endgame is. We don't know what the next step is. We don't know what three steps down the road might be. We haven't done the work with China. We haven't done the work with South Korea and Japan. We haven't done the work with our European allies. We haven't done the work with Russia to be prepared for what may come next in this crisis that we are creating. I'm fully on board with the notion that something needs to get done and that this administration needs to do it, but they ought to be doing it in a way that they have their ducks in a row, and I'm not sure they've got that quite yet.
Thank you very much, David. Wally, let me turn to you and maybe try to elicit your reflections on where we stand in respect to global and multilateral organizations and institutions. Certainly, if you think about the UN, if you think about NATO, If you think about major trade agreements like NAFTA or TPP or climate accords like the Paris Accord, you could imagine that the entire edifice of global security as we've come to know it in the post-World War II era is under sustained threat. So I wonder, reflecting as you can with your experience in these trade negotiations and just surveying the landscape of international economics, I wonder if it's your sense that indeed these multilateral and global institutions are under new and possibly dangerous pressure.
Well, let me start out by thanking you for having me. It is good to see some of my old colleagues again. It feels like it's been 3 months, but it feels like it's been much longer for the country since then. But I think that to a degree, these institutions have been under attack before President Trump came into office. And I think when you step back and look at it, the two events that have defined the 21st century thus far were the attacks on 9/11 and the global financial crisis. And those two things, to a degree, revealed, I think, tears in the seams of a social contract that had been developed post-World War II. And for a long time, the United States has served as the guarantor of peace and prosperity throughout the world by reinforcing a number of these institutions. And a number of the institutions we all know in some ways have needed to change, and many of them have changed. And part of what we spent the last 8 years trying to do was responding to the fact that the world had changed, and in it, our role needed to change as well. So that's why we pursued things like the TPP, because we recognized that for all the concerns with trade, ultimately, a country like the United States or a country like China were going to have to define the rules of trade going forward. We thought that by us defining those rules, it was in our interest, it was in the interest of the values that we shared. That's why we worked so hard to pursue the Paris Agreement, because we thought that by pursuing a global agreement, we put ourselves in the best possible position to solve some of the biggest issues that face the country with regard to climate change. And I think that early on in the Trump administration, we've seen, I think the thing that Lisa and David both speak to, I think, and you'll see that in the economic sense, is that in many ways the Trump administration has been very tactical in their approach to these issues, but not very strategic. And I think that ultimately, in order to repair these institutions and make sure they're prepared for the 21st century, there need to be strategic approaches. For example, many of the things that President Trump said about NATO with regard to our European allies needing to spend more are not messages that are new. There are messages that the Obama administration and the Bush administration before that shared with our allies in NATO. And I think that ultimately, seeing the president go from thinking that NATO was obsolete to becoming an institution that he believes has changed within 3 months isn't necessarily helpful to us appearing like we're strategically thinking about these relationships. And ultimately, unless I think the thing that I learned from my 8 years in government was that ultimately these institutions are far more fragile than people would like to think. And oftentimes, although the United States isn't the only voice in the room, we're often the voice that is constructively moving them forward in a way that leads to values-based institutions, be they the United Nations or NATO or the WTO. And without that voice, you're going to see things largely adrift for the moment. And you'll see actors like China, which is now saying that they are open for trade, trying to define the rules of the road in a way that benefit them and that ultimately will hurt America and our interests.
Thank you, Wally. Maybe just a brief public service announcement. There are a bunch of seats in the middle of the room here, and there's really no need. I mean, you're welcome to stand wherever you want. I like the idea of billing this as a standing room only event. But frankly, you know, although there are, you know, there were many people at the inauguration, and I'm sure there are many more people in this room, still, there are some open seats in the front. So
if you took the picture from here, it would look like an empty mall.
Right.
You take the point.
I see.
So,
leave it alone.
Colin, let me continue with you down this kind of line of everything is the same, but it's different. And maybe try to apply the same but different methodology or framework to Syria, an unmitigated, so it seems anyway, moral, political, strategic nightmare. So is it your view that the same but different framework more or less captures where things stand on Syria as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think if there's a theme, at least across some of the things that Lisa said and David said, and I think very consistent with what Wally said, is that the administration thus far has kind of had a escalate first, ask strategic questions later or never approach. And you're actually seeing that across the Middle East in a kind of creeping escalation that I think is largely below under the radar. And the cruise missile strike into Syria was very public, but not the only way in which the Trump administration is escalating across the board. I'll just give you a few data points. We've doubled the number of forces in northern Syria under the Trump administration from 500 when Obama left to close to 1,000 now. It wouldn't surprise me if that doubles again in the context of the campaign to take ISIS's capital of Raqqa in Syria. They've introduced hundreds of additional forces into Iraq and put thousands of additional forces into Kuwait on standby in case they have to go into Iraq. The pace of airstrikes has gone up, but also the intensity and the effect on civilians has gone up for the first time. Allegations of U.S.-caused civilian casualties are outpacing Russian-caused civilian casualties in Syria and Iraq. In a single strike last month in Mosul, we may have killed as many as 200 civilians. We've killed dozens of civilians in strikes against al-Qaeda and ISIS in northern Syria. And a lot of this, I think, is not because the rules of engagement have changed, but in part because the intensity of the campaign is picking up and, crucially, because the Trump administration has delegated a lot of authority for a lot of military activity to include strikes much closer to the front lines, away from the White House, away from the type of micromanagement that the Pentagon hated. And as a consequence, more strikes are being called in circumstances where perhaps the due diligence to avoid civilian casualties was not what it was before. And I say all of this to say that the missile strikes in Syria are just part and parcel of a broader escalation. I mean, just as one data point, the Trump administration has already conducted more than 70 airstrikes in Yemen this year, which is twice as many as the Obama administration carried out all of last year. And we're not even at day 100 yet. So in Syria, what is the same, what is different? What is same is that notwithstanding the cruise missile strikes on April 6th, the Trump administration continues to have an ISIS-first strategy as it relates to Syria. They may be dialing up the campaign, but largely the contours of it appear to be similar to what was the campaign they inherited from the Obama administration. The key question that we left to them, we asked them if they wanted us to leave it to them, and Michael Flynn at least said that they did, was this question of what force would take Raqqa. The campaign that was underway at the end of the Obama administration had the United States military essentially backing an organization called the Syrian Democratic Forces, which is an umbrella coalition largely encompassing a group of Kurdish militia known as the YPG that are very controversial with Turkey because of their affiliation with the PKK insurgency in Turkey, as well as associated Arab tribal forces. Our military would tell you that's the only game in town. They're the only forces capable of taking Raqqa. But because of the Kurdish component, the Turks see this as an existential challenge to them. You may have noted in the last 36 hours, the Turks actually bombed a bunch of these folks in northeastern Syria and on the border with Iraq as a sign of displeasure of us continuing to work with them. I will say you might have taken note about a week ago that Trump made the controversial decision to call President Erdogan of Turkey to congratulate him on democratic backsliding in Turkey. And I believe that the most generous interpretation of that phone call was to try to make the bitter pill of us working with the Kurds in Raqqa easier to swallow. It clearly didn't work, given that the Turks just bombed the heck out of the SDF in northern Syria. But I say all of this because the campaign is about to ratchet up in a way in Syria that's going to produce all sorts of diplomatic challenges. The Turks have carved out a buffer zone in northwest Syria with the twin goals of pushing ISIS off their border, which they've accomplished, and creating a buffer zone that prevents the Kurds from linking their territory and establishing an independent state all across Syria. Whatever the play on ISIS is, you're not going to have a sustainable outcome in Syria without some fundamental reconciliation between the Turks and the Kurds. What is the diplomatic play to make that happen? I know what we would have done. I'm not sure it would have been successful. I have no idea what they will do. And that is part and parcel of the fact that They have no idea what they're doing as it relates to diplomacy in Syria. If you ask every counterterrorism expert, they will say we can have short-term tactical and operational gains against the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda's affiliate in Syria. But that to sustainably defeat violent extremism in Syria, you have to de-escalate the war and it ultimately end the war. And there are only two ways to do that. You either put enough pressure on Assad and his patrons, you go right to the brink of all-out military confrontation and hope that they blink and Assad is moved to the side. We weren't willing to go all the way to that brink. I don't believe, despite what Nikki Haley says, the Trump administration is willing to go all the way. And I don't think that the strike on Assad was anything other than Trump trying to deter more chemical weapons and frankly prove he's the un-Obama by doing this in 63 hours. So I don't think they're gonna put more pressure on Assad or the Russians or the Iranians to push Assad out, which leaves you with what is there a political settlement that keeps Assad in power? There may be actually, because Syria has now fragmented into basically six different zones, all kind of controlled by different actors. You might be able to use that reality on the ground to frame a decentralized political solution and a ceasefire. My guess is that's what we would have done if there was a third Obama administration. But I don't know if they're gonna do that. And so the one critique, the meta critique I have of the escalate first, strategize later is, they're actually generating useful leverage in places. Mm-hmm. The strike against Assad was useful leverage with Assad and the Russians. The bellicose tweets and the armada steaming to North Korea provides some leverage with China and North Korea, right? They are doing some things which are actually useful, but they're only useful if there's a diplomatic strategy to take advantage of that leverage, and eventually that leverage will dissipate if you don't seize the moment. So I will conclude with this. It would have been a lot better for them, instead of taking 63 hours to strike Syria and then put Tillerson on a plane with no strategy to capitalize on it, to maybe take a couple of weeks, have a few more meetings,
yeah,
then strike Syria and figure out how to capitalize on that with the Russians.
Very sober and thoughtful remarks, everyone. So let's continue this conversation and maybe talk about certain relationships.
No, what did I say? Did I?
No, I think it's all right.
Go for it.
I'm gonna step all over you, Sam. So the
beware the unemployed man.
Yeah. So this reminds me of the old Veep episode where the
my comments.
No. All of our description here was I believe it was her. Her Selena Meyer's campaign slogan, which was continuity with change, right? And so I think we've all described that the Trump administration as continuity with a little change. I do think there are areas where there's been dramatic change that we haven't identified, which I think you were
just Russia asking. One of them?
Well, Russia's not, although only because it has also, I think, reverted to the mean.
Well, let me
with
me
the
put,
exception of the president.
Let me put Russia to the side, and David, since you have the floor, maybe I can just stay with you. Let's talk about the Iran deal a little bit, and maybe you would kind of adduce that as an example of change that the president has essentially promised and arguably delivered on. Would you agree with that assessment?
So I don't think he has delivered on that at all. The only tangible manifestations of their actual policy view towards the Iran deal was the certification last week that Iran was complying with the requirements under the deal, which the reporting said that, you know, the statement that Tillerson put out certifying compliance got somewhat more aggressive and pointing out Iranian misbehavior in the region, Iranian human rights abuses, but fundamentally still making the judgment, which, you know, was the judgment of the Obama administration, you know, supported from the intelligence community, that Iran was doing what they were required to do under the deal. I think the and I will say, I expect this administration not to blow up the Iran deal. I think they may try to work the Iranians into a place where they blow it up, and use that as the excuse, but I think they are appropriately wary of, they being the Trump administration, appropriately wary of backing out of the deal, because at that point they'd have zero chance of reimposing the sanctions, you know, zero chance of having any kind of international support for whatever it is that we would want to do without the nuclear deal being in place to restrain the Iran nuclear program. I think that, and I'll be very brief here, but I think the two areas where this administration has departed dramatically from the Obama administration is in the president's embrace of autocrats. So it's the call to Erdogan to congratulate him on the, how do you call it, the decline of democracy?
The
backsliding of democracy in Turkey. I think it's the president's continued inability to say a single critical word about President Putin, even as the rest of the administration seems to have embraced the, I think, the correct view that Russia is actually quite a serious foe. And I think the president's remarks after the most recent attack in Paris, right in the run-up to the election there on Sunday, that these terrorist attacks will help Le Pen, was putting his thumb on the scale of the worst of the autocrats out there. I don't know, it's a lot of competition with Putin, but she's pretty damn bad. And so I think embrace for autocracy over democracy, and related to this is the complete disinterest, or worse, about how the United States is perceived in the world. What has always been, for administration after administration going back decades, the emphasis on human rights, on the United States of America being a place where the downtrodden and the dispossessed can come to get their life back together. You know, all that they've done on the refugee and immigration executive order, just the essentially the downplaying of what I think makes this country great and what many people around the world look to this country to defend is a stark difference from what the Obama administration.
Now, I want to stay with this. Is obviously a huge theme for us, and I want to stay with this, but not right now. I want to kind of push the pause button on this question about American leadership in the world and American values and foreign policy. It's something I want to come back to. But let's stay, if we can, just for a moment, a little bit more kind of compact. David, that's a very helpful response and clarifying response on Iran. I wonder if we could just kind of tick off a few other relationships on my list here and take the measure of those relationships, which are after all so vital in thinking about what American foreign policy has come to mean. So let's talk about Russia a little bit. Lisa, I heard you to be saying a moment ago that Russia was a case of the reversion to the mean, but David at the same time is saying that, at least in President Trump's comments or public remarks about Putin, that we are in a brave new world. So given where you sat, so close to President Obama, obviously throughout his administration, but also and especially during the most recent presidential campaign, what's the deal?
So I think importantly, my reference to reversion to the mainstream was that there has been a bit of a meme that's been created about that. Some commentators have seen in reversals on China, the fact that there was the ability to have dinner at Mar-a-Lago without throwing food seemed to have been actually a big diplomatic accomplishment. And then that was viewed as a big reversal and a reversion to mainstream foreign policy of actually having some carrots. I'm not going to mix the food metaphor too far, I promise, by trying to appeal to China to pressure them on North Korea. That was seen as classic foreign policy approach and a helpful sign in a switch from the president. Similarly, in terms of the rhetoric and stern messages from Tillerson, from Nikki Haley on Russia, and as David points out, from everyone but the president, commentators have seen and described this as a reversion to mainstream policymaking. This is a bit depressing that it's just, more of our adversarial posture with Russia. as David pointed out, that has been true for everybody except for the president. He has been conspicuously, continuously silent on Russia's autocratic, to put it mildly, approach to the world, with one small, almost begrudging deviation vis-a-vis the chemical weapons attacks. And as David pointed out, and Colin, there was an almost purposeful refusal to actually capitalize on the leverage that the president had in his hands by executing the chemical weapons strikes, or the strike on the airfield. He could have armed Tillerson with a very, very stern, firm message, and importantly, a case to be made publicly to Russia and the public about the Syrian chemical weapons attacks, and laying out a case that Russia was, if not complicit, turning a purposeful blind eye. So that was, I think, as Colin said, leverage that was squandered. And so while there has been rhetoric from those in the administration that is consistent with a longstanding U.S. view that Russia is not a friend, but is most assuredly a serious foe for us, that has been absent, to say the least, from President Trump.
Colin, maybe I can stay with you on the question of less than fully democratic leadership, let's say, of nation states, and think about the backsliding that you talked about in the case of Turkey, and what that portends for United States strategic interests across the Middle East more broadly. I mean, what leaps to my mind, of course, are our relationships in the Gulf and how they are or are not in a different place now from where they might have been a couple months back, taking the kind of strategic point of view. Do you sense that there's something significant going on in American, let's say, reassuring or reassurances being directed towards our Saudi or Emirati partners, just to take it for instance?
Yeah, I mean, not to get too historical or philosophical, but going back to the founding, presidents of the United States have defined the identity of the United States and part and parcel as in terms of our values. The main disagreement has not been about whether American values define our identity and enhance our power and security. There's actually been a consensus about that. The disagreement has been whether we best promote our values by serving as a shining example, a city on a hill, or as Barack Obama used to say, that we should focus on perfecting our union and living up to our values, or whether we should be more assertive in our promotion of human rights and democracy abroad, a more kind of redemptivist as opposed to exemplarist model. What's so interesting about Trump is that he doesn't define American greatness in terms of our values at all. He defines our greatness largely in terms of how rich we are and how big our military is. And that type of material power matters, as a political scientist, to our power, but it's not the be-all and end-all of American influence. And I know enough about the history of the world, and especially of the post-World War II order, that standing up for our values, which includes standing up for a rule-based international order that are to some degree grounded in those values, as Wally pointed out, has always magnified American power exponentially beyond what our material might would be. And so Trump impoverishes us by not talking about values and not living up to them either at home or abroad. And I also think that he is basically unlearned all of the hard lessons we learned about the Middle East from the Bush administration. He's kind of embraced a certain shock and awe pyrotechnics, believing that the more countries we're bombing, the more leadership we have. He has gone back to a full embrace of autocrats across the region. Even if Obama was still around, we would have to deal with Erdogan just like Trump has to deal with Erdogan. You don't have to call him up on the phone and congratulate him on a referendum that moves Erdogan in a very Putin-like direction in Turkey. That was a conscious decision. So he's fed it el-Sisi. The Saudis have been through the calls with Erdogan. So it's not just that they don't talk about our values or human rights. They are actively working to signal that we don't care at all. And it's also interesting that as he basically doesn't criticize Putin, he treats our allies as morally equivalent. He got along with Angela Merkel, but he doesn't actually see Angela Merkel as all that different qualitatively from Putin. They're just leaders of big, important countries, and we can cut deals with anybody. And there's a certain immoral transactionalism at the heart of Trump's art of the global deal that actually does pushes values completely to the side. And the way that that plays out in the Middle East is highly problematic, because we're bombing a bunch of countries and killing a bunch of civilians. That's gonna come back to haunt us. We have this refugee and migration ban that Trump framed as a Muslim ban multiple times and is perceived as such, that's thankfully tied up in the courts, but undermines our argument that we actually are different and more tolerant and not at war with Islam, and instead, as Lisa said, feeds the narrative that Baghdadi, the head of ISIS, wants, which is basically that there is, that you have to obliterate the gray zone, that every Muslim around the world has to choose between capitulating to the West or emigrating to the Islamic State. And this immigration and refugee ban is designed to force people to make that choice. And then by embracing autocrats, you're basically embracing the folks who lock up opposition figures and crack down on moderate Islamist groups, forcing people into jihadi organizations. If you look at where Al-Qaeda came from, it came from prisons in Egypt. Okay, let's be, and the Muslim Brotherhood, I don't agree with their ideology, but I'd much rather have a Muslim Brotherhood as a moderate alternative that can operate and embrace politics of some sort than to basically brutally crack down on it in a way that shoves all of those young people into Salafist jihadi organizations, whether they be Al-Qaeda or ISIS affiliates. So it strikes me that Trump has learned all the wrong lessons from the Bush administration, and I will conclude with this. He's adopted what I call a kind of bizarro Goldilocks approach. Not hot enough, not cold enough, just wrong. So he's basically embraced a certain muscular militarism from the Bush administration, but a certain distance from the Obama administration, but with none of the diplomacy. And so you get this kind of perfectly imperfect or dysfunctional strategy that's gonna go around breaking a lot of stuff with no strategy to put Humpty Dumpty back together or to extricate us from all the conflicts we're getting into.
Wally, let me turn to China, since we've solved all of our other problems, apparently. One way to conceptualize TPP, certainly not the only way, but one way would have been to think about it as a deliberate, coherent framework for constraining China's exercise of economic but also strategic power. And one way to think about its undoing, therefore, is to think about undermining that objective. Now here, as in all the other cases that we've talked about, there's been a certain amount of volatility. China was a currency manipulator until it wasn't, and China may now be our best bet, or a significant bet anyway, on trying to advance the agenda that this administration has with respect to North Korea. So if you could offer some reflections based on your own experience and your outlook on where you see the China relationship going.
I think China is probably the country that I spent the most time with. I think before moving to the White House, I saw President Xi more than I saw President Obama on a regular basis, because the economic relationship with them was so important. So secretaries of the Treasury would spend time with the Chinese president on a regular basis. And I think that the interesting thing to see is that something you would have never seen President Obama do was say that if you help us solve North Korea, we'll give you a better trade deal. And it's hard to understand. It speaks, I think, to what we've been talking about. The president at the moment seems to be very focused on tactics, but not on strategy. The relationship with China is a complicated one. China's not only the second biggest economy, but it has a large military. And North Korea is not the only issue we have there. You have the South China Sea. You have a number of other issues that you're dealing with the Chinese on. And if you focus myopically on one issue, you leave the Chinese with the ability to run the gamut on a bunch of other issues. I think trade is an important one, because in reality, the United States and China are the two biggest economies in the world. We always thought of TPP and our trade relationships in the Asia Pacific as important to us, because that's one where growth is happening. The economies are growing there. Their demographics there are favorable. We want to be able to sell American goods and services in that region, but we want to sell them based on what we would call a level playing field. The Chinese, on the other hand, have a view that they want to define the rules of trade in a way that favor the Chinese. And that's why we press so aggressively for TPP. And I think that by President Trump withdrawing us from TPP without an alternative approach leaves us in a place where we are ceding the ground to the Chinese. All over the world we're doing this, not only in the not only in parts of East Asia where we're paying attention, but if people aren't paying attention, but you look at Pakistan. Pakistan right now is on its way potentially to a balance of payment crisis. Traditionally, what a country would do in that situation is they go to the IMF. But China has been giving Pakistan money to help them get through this balance of payment crisis so they don't have to go to the IMF before their election. This is going to draw them closer to Pakistan, which is not fundamentally in our interest. It creates more instability in that region than we want. It will further alienate the relationship between Pakistan and India, which is something that no one wants. But the Trump administration has been largely silent on this. And I think that what you're seeing is that by them wanting to pull away from international agreements like TPP without a strategy as to what comes after it, they're creating room for China, who sees themselves as needing places to trade and sell goods, and also wanting to establish a sphere of influence in Asia that keeps us out. It gives them the ability to do that, especially if we're just going to focus on one thing like North Korea. And I think that North Korea, the Chinese are clearly the country that has the most influence over North Korea. But unlike what President Trump has demonstrated so far, the Chinese have a clear strategy. And they are looking at this as a multifaceted relationship. And if President Trump is going to push over here and let them go over here, they're going to just walk and create a world that favors their interests, not only economically, but from a national security standpoint.
Can I add something to that? I think another example, particularly with China, where the tactical focus on the discussion with North Korea, with China about North Korea, is dangerous for us, is in the cyber realm. So the example I would give is in every engagement anybody from the Obama administration had with anybody from the Chinese government, and most certainly President Obama to President Xi, at the very top of whatever the talking points were, included a very tough message on China's malicious cyber activity, including, most importantly, I would argue, their cyber-enabled economic espionage against our companies. It was only through relentless messaging to them, backed up by the threat of financial sanctions, that China was brought to the table before President Xi's visit in the fall of September 2015 to the United States to kind of back off some of their activity and sign up to a set of norms. Now, is it all peace and shining, you know, happiness with the Chinese on cyber? Absolutely not. But the intelligence community would tell you that we did see a diminution of their malicious cyber activity after that set of pressures and that threat of sanctions.
We did.
There we go. Now, I watched carefully the discussions about the summit in Mar-a-Lago. I didn't hear word one about us delivering a stern message to China about malicious cyber activity. If the Chinese believe, as Wally said, that we're only thinking about a tactical discussion with them on North Korea and everything else is fair business and it's, you know, back to their old ways, that spells real trouble for us, for our companies, and for our standing in the world as being those who are going to stand up for a set of norms to include against malicious cyber activity.
Okay, let's turn to some kind of big conceptual themes, and I've got a couple of more questions to ask, maybe one for each of you, and maybe this is also fair warning for anyone in the audience who wants to raise a question. Now would be a good time to begin thinking about it, formulating it, and so forth. Why don't we start by talking a little bit about process and decision-making in institutions, because I think one of the things that many of you have touched upon, and certainly something that's been reported on extensively in the press, has been the, let's call it, unorthodox decision-making in this administration. And we could take this conversation in lots of different directions. We could talk about the placement and then the removal of Steve Bannon from the National Security Council. We could talk about the militarization of foreign policy making in the form of generals who occupy senior positions. We could talk about the diminution, if that's what's going on, of law from a role that had been, I think, across both the Bush and the Obama administrations, central to the strategic calculus, certainly in the counterterrorism domain, possibly to the point where law has receded in importance and maybe come to occupy the more standard pre-9/11 kind of role, namely kind of lawyers as pests who kind of chip away at the margins and maybe paper the document, but aren't really mission critical to executing the mission or thinking about the strategy and so forth. So with that, a kind of open-ended question, kind of more like a provocation to any and all of you, like, where do we stand on national security process? Is it really important? And, you know, how do our institutions function? You know, Lisa, you've used the metaphor of chairing the meeting, so.
So, look, I would add to the list that David was creating about where things have had a dramatic change, where we've seen a dramatic change, and I would say where I've seen a dramatic change thus far has been in the what seems to me to be a rejection of institutions, process, expertise, subject matter experts, and turning the phrase career government employee into a bit of a dirty word. And as somebody who spent 20 plus years in government, the majority of that actually as a career government employee, as opposed to in political roles, including as a prosecutor, that spells trouble. And it spells trouble no matter what partisan stripe you are. This is not about partisan politics. This is about having institutions and process that will endure and that presidents of any stripe can rely on. And so we've seen in some of the things that you mentioned has been a rejection of those institutions. So why is it important? I mean, just use the National Security Council process. I think it's vitally important to have some consistent policymaking forum where people of multiple views from different agencies are going to be able to come to the table and know that that's the real meeting. Know that that's where the decision is going to be formed, where the recommendations and the options are going to be formed and then presented to the president, and that there's going to be give and take on that. We haven't, I think the jury again is out on whether that is actually taking place. We saw some signs, admittedly, in a rather rushed way in the Syria strike decision-making context, that there was at least some process and there was a delivery to the president of a set of options that had been worked by his national security team. We'll see. Is that going to now blossom and take hold in a more kind of regular order type of way? I think it's very important that it do, because the more voices and equities, as we used to say in the government bureaucraties, that you have around the table, I think the better the discussion and the decisions are ultimately going to be. Is it possible to take that to an extreme that some would call dithering? Sure, but I do think that there is a not bizarro Goldilocks, but a just right way to do it.
Go ahead, Colin. Yeah.
So just to pile on to that, I think they came in during the transition with a critique, some of which, frankly, would have been a critique that the Clinton folks would have embraced too, which was that we had too much process. We were too deliberative. We were too micromanaging. We were too operational. That we had that we were too legalistic, that we had overcranked, and that you had to set some equilibrium to the left of wherever we were. The problem is they have massively overcorrected, and they've done it in a way that's supremely imbalanced in favor of the Defense Department. So they have given enormous expansions of authorities to the Defense Department. They've defined entire swaths of countries where we were not previously at war at, like Yemen and Somalia, now as areas of active hostilities, meaning that the military has the same authorities to do the stuff they do in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria in places like Yemen and Somalia. The Defense Department has said they're no longer going to announce when they put troops into countries, which reduces the transparency and public accountability there, but it's consistent with Trump's notion that he wants to keep things secret and not, you know, telegraph our punches to our enemies. And I got a call from a reporter the other day who had caught word that the Trump administration may give the Pentagon blanket authority to determine what are known as FML levels across the Middle East, which basically means the Pentagon can determine all by itself how many boots in the ground we put without any checks from the interagency or from the President of the United States. You heard after the mother of all bombs was dropped in Afghanistan and Trump was asked, did you authorize it? He goes, we all know what happened. Well, we know what happened. He didn't authorize it. But he said, I've given them total authorization. No commander-in-chief gives his Pentagon total authorization. But in this case, there is such supreme deference to the Pentagon. They're the ones who get the resources, they're the ones who get the blank check, and it adds to that challenge that you have so many generals in the cabinet, and that H.R. McMaster, who is an amazingly smart guy and such an improvement as a national security advisor, and I have an enormous faith in him, nevertheless, his instincts are to give a lot of deference to Jim Mattis at the state and to Joe Dunford at the Pentagon. And then at the same time, they're basically gutting the civilian agencies. Not only do they have budgets that slash the State Department and the USAID by a third, which Congress will probably claw back a chunk of that, but they are going to get cut, but they're gutting them in other ways as well. They're completely and thoroughly demoralizing the workforce, describing everybody who works in the bureaucracy as deep state holdovers, part of the administrative state that needs to be deconstructed. And they're not letting cabinet secretaries actually staff their buildings. And so you have entire chunks of our government that aren't the Pentagon completely adrift. Rex Tillerson is a State Department of one at the moment. And that, you know, and whatever you think of his performance so far, you can't run diplomacy with one person. And the last point I would make is one of the ways you solve this is maybe not having as many meetings as the Obama administration has, but you should have some meetings. And they're not having a lot. McMaster's having more than Flynn did. But frankly, the way that this president makes his big decisions is around the dinner table. All right. He meets with his cabinet officials over dinner, oftentimes at Mar-a-Lago. They have conversations, and then he just makes a decision. So, for example, the infamous Yemen raid that killed that Navy SEAL and a couple dozen civilians in Yemen at the very beginning of the Trump administration was decided over dinner with Jim Mattis and Joe Dunford. And the problem is, it depends on who else is at the dinner table. If the intel folks aren't at the dinner table and the State Department's at that, there's a reason why you have those meetings in the Situation Room with everybody else around the table so that you can actually bring arguments, analysis, and equities to bear on the biggest questions that we have and then tee those decisions up to the president. And that's the part that I really worry about process-wise.
David, Colin mentioned the word transparency. And I want to take the conversation off into a slightly different direction and to hear you, the former number two official at the Central Intelligence Agency, talked to us a little bit about transparency, a value that is, I would say, of utmost importance to many, especially, here I'm going to practice some ageism, especially I think the student population here and kind of younger people in general, I think, have really embraced the value of transparency. It's a value that stands in some tension or awkwardness with the secrecy with which the intelligence mission is necessarily carried out. Of late, the CIA director, Mike Pompeo, had some pretty harsh things to say about Julian Assange, notwithstanding that the president on the campaign trail had some pretty favorable or non-critical things to say about Julian Assange. So how is it that we can have a transparent national security or intelligence apparatus even as we continue the tradition of practicing national security in some modicum of secrecy?
Thanks for the softball. So I would say a couple of things. One is the faux use of national security to justify lack of transparency is something that I think is worthy of criticism. So I think the best example is the administration's decision not to release the visitor logs at the White House on the on the theory that somehow that was going to threaten our national security, which is like utter BS, right? The what it threatens is what you might imagine it threatens is that, you know, that people can know who's coming in to lobby the administration on various things. And it had always been the case that if there were a legitimate national security reason to excise from the visitor log a particular visitor, that could be done. And so I think the embrace of national security as the sort of uber explanation for lack of transparency, I think quite rightly undermines the strength of the argument, which is a one that I think is valid in many circumstances, that national security does necessarily entail some lack of transparency. So that's, I think, unfortunate. The other area where I think transparency comes into play is we talked about this a little bit in the counterterrorism mission. And there were a number of national security, former national security officials who signed on to a letter to General Mattis and others talking about how the counterterrorism mission ought to be pursued. And we made a number of points in that letter. Lisa was on that letter. I was on that letter. I think Colin should have been on the letter. It was good. It was a good letter. Lisa wrote it. But one of the points that we made in there was that the counterterrorism mission ought to be, to the extent we can, carried out by the Defense Department. And one of the reasons why that is so is because when the Defense Department engages in a counterterrorism operation, we can talk about it. We can claim credit where credit is due. We can acknowledge mistakes when mistakes were made. And I think what we are seeing in this administration is a somewhat of a regression from what had been the move in the Obama administration to have more transparency to the extent we can in our counterterrorism mission. So, why don't I stop there?
That's very helpful, maybe a little bit cryptic to some, but I think for many others, kind of very, very important. I
thought it was pretty forward-leaning.
Forward-leaning and cryptic all at the same time. Wally, maybe we could conclude this portion of the conversation with my asking you about some kind of big overarching themes in contemporary national security and foreign policy. It's not just about relationships and countries and hard power. Surely big ideas and concepts like the role of technology and the role of demography or of climate and environment are key drivers of American national security thinking and practice. So I wonder if you could give us your reflections on, you know, in 60 seconds or 120 seconds or 3 minutes or less, how these big themes, these big tectonic developments are ramifying on national security.
I think you're right. There are three things I think that below the seams have changed the way our countries work. One is globalization. I think we spent a lot of time talking about that. The second one is technology, and technology is going to have a huge impact on our economy and on our military. And we have to have a strategy for both. And I don't think that at the moment this administration has spent enough time or set up the structures to address that. And then demographics are going to matter. When you look, the president's going to go to the G7 meeting in a few weeks. I think this is going to be an opportunity that they should capture for him to define both what he wants to do on the security front and bring our traditional allies along, but also to talk about economics. What does he want to do in terms of economics? Because all of our traditional allies, be it Europe or Japan, their populations are shrinking. Their economies are not growing as fast as China's economy. And we face those same challenges here in the United States. Fundamentally, demographics, globalization, technology are going to both define the future of our economy and of our national security in ways that are fundamental, and we're going to need strategies to address them. I think that in the Obama administration, these were things we spent time thinking about, spent time trying to address, and I think Lisa's point about cyber is a place where this is going to be the most critical. You look at everything from cybersecurity to technology related to semiconductors. This is going to matter a great deal, and there are places where our allies, we're going to have to work with our allies to solve these problems because we can't solve them alone, even though so far the president in many ways has taken a go-it-alone approach to both national security and economic policy. Fundamentally, that's impossible over time if we want to maintain the quality of life we become accustomed to in this country and to maintain the security posture that we've had over the last, since World War II. So I think that fundamentally we're going to need to address these questions in this administration, or they'll be addressed for us by countries like China, where they will make decisions that will change the status quo in ways that will meaningfully impact us economically and from a national security perspective.
Thank you very much, Wally. The floor is now yours. At the very end of the conversation, I'm going to come back to each of you to reflect about that issue, David, that you raised earlier, namely about American foreign policy in light of American values. I think it's something that you touched upon, but maybe it's something we want to come back to by way of kind of wrapping up. But in the meanwhile, go ahead.
I just have two questions. You can put your mic on or put the mic next. There you go.
Just two quick questions, and one primarily to Wally and the other to Colin. The first, so the title of this discussion is A New World Order, and there was a recent article by Bob Cohen, who sort of doesn't get more kind of Washington blob or elite internationalist as him, and the article is entitled The Liberal World Order is Rigged, and it's kind of about, in terms of staffing, in terms of corporation access to international fora, the kind of Davosification of international institutions. Do you buy that argument? And if you do buy it, or if you don't, sort of what are the implications now? You see Trump is making moves on NAFTA, the future of TPP, and those kinds of international institutions and economic relationships. And on the second, mostly for Colin, but for the rest of the panel, do you believe in the sort of Nixonian kind of linkage of policy between Russia and Syria, as far as our inaction in Syria in 2013 enabled part of the Ukraine crisis, and our response to Ukraine kind of enabled Syrian action Russian action in Syria in 2016. And if you do or don't believe that, do you kind of buy the grand bargain theory where we can try and, you know, sort of sell Ukraine to buy back Syria?
Two very good questions. I'll try and speak long enough for Colin to think about his. So I think in terms of the game being rigged, I think that what the reality is that, and I think this is clear from globalization, that in many ways since China's accession to the WTO at the end of the last century, we've seen that many of the benefits of globalization have been concentrated near the top of the economy. But in addition to being concentrated near the top of the economy, you've also seen some of those benefits be dispersed throughout the economy. For example, consumer goods are far cheaper now than you would expect but for globalization, but people don't see that necessarily in their paycheck. You've also seen a concentration of the harm in terms of manufacturing jobs that exist in places like Ohio. You've seen those. You've seen that harm, and I think that we did in many ways fail to come up with an economic strategy for dealing with the dislocation that we thought would take longer to occur, but was very concentrated. And I do think that part of our response in TPP was to try and make sure that we had strong labor standards, we had environmental standards, and I think that we do need to look at ways to change the rules of the global trading regime, but the thing you can't do is withdraw from global trade, because the global economy is so big, and if the United States withdraws, it's not as if global trade is going to stop. The rules are going to be set by China. And if anyone thinks the rules set by China are going to be better for our employees than the rules that we set, I think that I have a bridge I want to sell them, you know? So I think that fundamentally, the question is that, yeah, there are things that need to be fixed with regard to the global economic order. But in reality, the thing that's going to drive change going forward, globalization will be a big part of it, is going to be technology. And I promise that AI is going to have a far more disruptive impact on workers in America than globalization has. And I don't think at the moment that there are credible strategies for how we deal with that dislocation, but we need to come up with that very soon because AI is coming.
So, well, first of all, Wally, thanks for buying all that time. A couple of things. I think as it relates to, you know, whether Obama was, you know, too weak too feckless on Syria, that invited Russian aggression either in Syria or around the world. I'm not persuaded by it, and not just because I worked in the Obama administration, but I know enough political science not to be persuaded about it. But let me take it in some pieces. I don't think that our weakness in Syria, that is, not putting enough pressure on the regime, is what invited the Russians in. In fact, if you look at the timeline of the Russian intervention, it happens in the fall of 2015. And why does it happen? It happens because Putin and Qasem Soleimani, the head of the IRGC Quds force in Iran, conclude that Assad has 3 to 6 months to live. That is, that the broader coalition, of which we were supportive, that aided the opposition, had Assad on the ropes. And so Russia's intervention was precisely because of the pressure put on Assad, not because of some perception of American weakness. I'm also not persuaded that what they did in 2014 in Ukraine had anything to do with what we did or didn't do in Syria, not only because the political science literature is actually pretty clear that there's not a lot of transferability between deterrence failures. That is, you can fail in one instance, but countries tend to make judgments based on their assessment of your capabilities and interests as it relates to a particular issue as opposed to other issues. And I think this is particularly persuasive in the context of Ukraine, because I think when Putin saw Ukraine, he didn't see American weakness in Syria. What he saw was the American tendency in general to support regime change. And he interpreted the Maidan revolution and the ouster of Yanukovych in the context of color revolutions and US support for regime change to include what he believes is US backing for regime change in Russia. Right? It's one of the reasons why Putin hated Hillary and why he worked to help elect Trump and all of the rest. Sorry, did I say that out loud? Anyway, So part of it was, I think, that he perceived American animosity in the context of supporting regime change in Ukraine, which was threatening to Russian interests, and in general that he saw the vacuum in Ukraine creating an ability for the West to encroach further toward the Russian homeland, which of course is part of Putin's broader critique since the end of the Cold War, that we basically sold him a bill of goods and have, you know, encircled Russia, taking advantage of the collapse of the Soviet Union to expand NATO, et cetera. So I think he was worried about what turmoil in Ukraine would do, and so he went in and seized Crimea with those little green men and fomented violence in the Donbass, which continues to be a problem to this day. In terms of whether we could sacrifice Ukraine to get cooperation in Syria, I would just make two points. One, it would be a really bad idea to sacrifice Ukraine, because it is true that Ukraine was a Russian puppet prior to the Maidan, and therefore maybe it doesn't matter if they kind of went back to being within Russia's sphere of influence. The problem is signaling that we don't have a problem with Russia tearing up the inviolability of borders in Europe, and also throwing into doubt the entire issue of whether a Europe whole, free, and at peace is something that European countries get to decide, which is very much part of that formative, normative, rule-based order that we support in Europe. I think it's very dangerous to throw Ukraine under the bus in that context. I also just don't think it's necessary to get cooperation in Syria. If the Russians want, look, Trump liked to talk about how, you know, he, you know, Putin's not such a bad guy, and why wouldn't we want to cooperate with Putin against ISIS? Well, we don't need to throw Ukraine under the bus to cooperate with Putin with ISIS. He wants our counterterrorism cooperation because it legitimizes his military campaign inside of Syria. We don't have to give him squat for that. In fact, the fact that he wants it is leverage for us that we tried to exploit at the end of the Obama administration and came this close, and that actually the Trump administration maybe has another bite at that apple. And the only other point I would make on this is there's some other leverage we have too on Syria, and I'll leave you with this. Assad is winning, but he's not going to take over his entire country. All right, it's not going to happen. And as it stands now, their price tag to rebuild Syria is north of $100 billion. If the United States doesn't step up with Europe and with the UN and with the wealthy Gulf states and the wealthy Asian states to provide tens of billions of dollars to Syria, who gets stuck with that bill? The Russians, the Iranians, and Assad. I know that Trump hates nation building, but man, is that a powerful piece of leverage. So if you want to get the Russians on side, then you put conditions on our counterterrorism cooperation, and you say that we will help mobilize massive assistance for Syria hinged on a particular political settlement. That's the way you get a deal, not by throwing Ukraine under the bus.
Okay, why don't we do this? Why don't we take two or possibly even three questions at a time. And why don't we begin right here? Yes, ma'am.
Miki Noguchi, Franklin Street Policy Group. I appreciate all of the sort of not report card, but at least like sort of where status report of where we are today. And the picture is not sunny, but the fact is that no matter the amount of preparation that's been done and the setup that was sort of done in the transition in the previous administration, we have to respond to the facts that are on the ground today and think about what does this look like, regardless of administration, what does this world look like? What do these global challenges look like going forward in a way that is, what are the partnership opportunities? Where are there actually some rays of light coming through where it's not all an entirely depressing scenario?
Okay, so I'm going to take that to mean what are some potential bright spots or...
Exactly, partnership.
Yeah. Where, what are some opportunities exactly that have been created? Some of you. Sir.
Just this is sort of related to what Colin said in his last remarks. I, as a baby boomer and a veteran of the post-Vietnam era, I think a lot about what I guess I would call endless war or endless regional conflict. And with the resurgence of Taliban, if that is the case, are we in or out of the counterinsurgency and nation-building business at this point? And what should we be doing?
Thank you. And why don't we take one more question? Yes, ma'am.
Well, thank you very much, Gorgia Damaeze. I'd like to go back to what Colin raised regarding American values. I'd like to mention the global refugee crisis. And wouldn't this be a perfect opportunity for the Trump administration to take leadership on the international scene as regards refugees and partnering with both Europe and NATO? And I know there's a striking a balance on the one hand, the national security of the United States and the question of refugees and this issue of, you know, xenophobia and majority of refugees are supposed to be infiltrated by ISIS. But one can't help feeling, after all, the America itself was built by refugees. I feel, for one, that this would have been a perfect opportunity for the Trump administration to basically take his stand on the international community as regards the refugee crisis. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the floor is yours.
I'll start in terms of positive. I'll try and be a little bit positive. Opportunities. Look, I think there's opportunity we tried to make and exploit that the Trump administration could capitalize on, and that's with the Emirates, right? The UAE is the most capable partner in the region from a military and counterterrorism perspective. They've been working with us in Afghanistan for a decade, and they've shown real, frankly, skin in the game and capability in both the campaign against ISIS in Iraq and Syria and in Yemen. So I think that there's an opportunity to really expand that and grow that relationship and to do so in a way that is in our interest so that we would actually have finally an anchor partner in the region who can do more on the military side. You know, we have other partners in the region. Jordan's one of them that has some capabilities, but when it comes to real counterterrorism work, there's really there's precious few in the region who we can rely on their capabilities. So I would say that's a place that they should really work on.
Just in terms of opportunities, I actually think the biggest opportunities that we have globally are on both sides of the Pacific. They're in Asia and the Western Hemisphere. And that's something that I think Obama recognized right out of the gate, especially initially with the rebalance to Asia itself. And then I think through the TPP, this notion that actually both sides of the Pacific equation are where America's destiny in the 21st century lie. That is still true. The second opportunity that we have is that if we maintain a dynamic, open, engaged economy, there's no reason why we won't continue to have the most creative companies, the most innovations, that we can dominate technologies in the energy sector and other things that really give us an edge over almost every other country in the world. The problem is, if you're talking about Asia, the Western Hemisphere, and a dynamic, open economy, the Trump administration is signaling a reversal in every single case. They've torn up TPP already. Trump has ruining the relationship with Mexico and calling into question the relationship in the Western Hemisphere by treating immigrants from that from Latin America with such disrespect here in the United States. And as it relates to a dynamic open economy, it doesn't mesh with the kind of economic nationalist notions of protectionism and mercantilism that Trump's economic policies are rooted around. Let me just say one thing about the refugee crisis. You will notice that when Trump justified the strike in Syria, he made a big point about all those dead kids. Yeah. Although 400 dead kids died in 2013, and he didn't want Obama to strike, but when he was president, he was persuaded by the dead kids. There are a lot more Syrian kids fleeing Assad every single day, thousands, that his refugee ban would prevent from coming into the United States, and would also rob us of the leadership to do precisely the type of leadership on the refugee issue that President Obama tried to do in his final years, culminating in the big summit at the UN General Assembly. So I would say to Trump, if you really care about Syrian kids, how about letting them in to the country? But he's not gonna do it. He won't do it because, and I will be brutally honest, the economic nationalist piece of Trump's foreign policy may ebb and flow depending on whether Gary Cohn or Navarro or Bannon, who's up or who's down, but the cultural nationalism at the heart of Trump's agenda is the heart of his agenda, and it is the heart of his base. And so much of that is rooted in anti-immigrant and Islamophobic ideas that they're never going to lead on the refugee issue. The idea is to prevent them from coming to the United States and keep them in those countries, so they will never move on that issue, in my view.
Yeah. I'll be brief on the opportunity point to come back to what I was saying at the outset. I do think there is an opportunity on North Korea and an opportunity that the administration needs to seize, and that is to capitalize on the focus that they have brought to this issue and to really try to test the proposition that there is some way to separate Kim Jong-un from his nuclear program. Now, there may not be. It may be that what Kim Jong-un cares about most in the world is the Kim dynasty and ensuring its survival, and that he sees the only way to accomplish that is to have the ability to hold the United States at risk with a nuclear-tipped ICBM. And if that's the case, if those two things are completely conjoined, we'll never get a productive negotiation going. We'll have to revert to some form of a deterrence and defense approach to North Korea. But if there's any daylight in there, what this administration is creating the opportunity to take advantage of is to just drive right into that daylight and try and split it. And the way to do that, I think, is, as I was alluding to earlier, is to try to split Kim Jong-un from the Pyongyang elite so that he begins to fear an internal uprising against him. That's the way that he could then come to the conclusion that he needs to negotiate on his nuclear program in order to relieve the pressure that is splitting him from the elite. It avoids the danger that he thinks we're about to strike first, which has all the escalatory dangers I was talking about earlier. And it I think, plays on the only mechanism to test the proposition that there's a potentially productive negotiation to get going here. So I think this administration is moving in that direction. I think they need a strategy. I think they need to work with their allies, with our allies, to work on this, but I think there is an opportunity there to try and address what I think is one of the most serious security threats that we face.
I think I'll be very brief. I think the one place where there is an opportunity is on the Paris Climate Change Agreement. I think people assume that when President Trump came into office, he would quickly withdraw us from the Paris Agreement in the same way he withdrew us from TPP. I think that the Obama administration's work over the last year to bring the agreement into force rather than just sign the agreement, I think is paying dividends because it is hard to remove ourselves from the Paris Agreement. And a number of people who the president listens to from the business community are talking to him about the importance of remaining in the agreement because America wants to have a seat at the table when the rules of the road with regard to climate policy are designed. Despite what they're doing domestically, I think that there is still a case for us staying in this agreement and participating in the international conversation on these issues. I think there's a chance that the president will decide to remain in this conversation, and hopefully that will help move us in the right direction, because once we withdraw, countries like China and Europe will define the rules of the road with regard to this issue in a way that hopefully we'll continue to favor the kind of change that needs to happen overall for the climate, but will ultimately favor their companies and their firms over ours in the global economy. So I'm hopeful that this is a place where President Trump, like in the case of NATO, has seen massive change occur so he can remain in the agreement.
We're in the penalty time here, and I'm mindful of it, and I want to make sure everyone gets their CLE credit, but I don't want to outstay our welcome. But why don't we do, we have time for, let's say, two more quick questions, and then we'll kind of wrap up. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you all very much. I just say as a general note to the panel that I think you underestimate Jared Kushner. That was a joke. Or as John McCain calls him, the 35-year-old. I have a question about what you foresee in regard to policy toward Israel. Will there be more proliferation of settlements? When Netanyahu came, Trump essentially gave lip service and said that the settlements were not helpful, but yet they continue to be constructed.
Thank you.
Yep, so my question's primarily for Wally, but I think Lisa can also jump on this. So there are a lot of reasons why the TPP has ended up going down now, and I don't think we need to get into all of them today. But my question for you is, given that the Trump administration clearly has very little expertise and very little interest in global trade at this point, what can those outside of the administration do to ensure that we don't completely destroy our relationships with those allies who do want to do business with us in the future?
Okay, so the challenge to the panel is to tackle that last question on trade, the one about Israel and settlement policy, and to marble into your responses some reflections on American stature and moral leadership in the world. Over to you.
Back then. Okay.
And defend 35-year-olds.
Yeah, I'll defend 35-year-olds too. So I think that on trade, I think that it fundamentally comes down to, I think, just, and it'll, I'll tie in the answer here to our place in the world. Fundamentally, I think that the thing that makes us the most unique as a people in a country are the people who are gathered in the United States of America. The diversity of this country make us strong, and also the creativity of Americans. I think that unfortunately at the moment it appears that many of the things that have made us strong are things that President Trump is resisting. But fundamentally, I think that Americans are going to continue to interact in the world. We're going to continue to be seen as leaders in science and in industry and in other forms of academia and in business. And we're going to have to find ways to continue to interact with our counterparts across the world as we do business with them. And I think the best thing we can individually do is continue to carry ourselves mindful of those values that we believe in as a country. Because fundamentally, we are a democracy, and President is our democratically chosen leader, but our country is made up of the hundreds of millions of people who live here. I think that it comes down to us having debates like this one and discussions to demonstrate to the world that although the current view in the White House might be X, there's an active debate in our country about the future direction that we go in. I think on trade specifically, we're going to need to find a way to make trade work better for more Americans. And I think it's something that we started to do at the end of the Obama administration by making TPP a new kind of trade agreement. But in addition to that, we're going to need to look at how we redefine the global trading system, not only to the benefit of Americans, but to the benefit of people who are angry about it in the UK and in France and around the world. And that's a debate that people like you and me should be engaged in, because it's not just an American debate, but it's a debate that's going to matter to citizens around the world.
On Israel, a couple of things. I think initially the settler community in the far right in Israel was quite optimistic about Trump. I think a combination of the, you know, his criticism of the Obama administration's abstention in the context of the UN Security Council resolution that condemned settlements at the end of the Obama administration, in Trump's choice for ambassador to Israel, you know, his lawyer, but also a guy who had contributed to settler causes in the past and was quite hawkish in that regard. I think some of that has been dialed back, frankly, despite Trump, you know, saying one state, two state, whatever, that basically the administration has you know, reaffirmed that they support a two-state outcome. I do think actually Trump believes that the Israeli-Palestinian deal is one of the big deals that he would like to accomplish. I think he understands that he can't accomplish that by giving a complete blank check to Netanyahu. My guess is Netanyahu also benefits from him not having a complete blank check and being able to communicate that to his right flank as Likud continues to move right and he gets challenged from other right-wing parties. So you've seen the Trump administration, you know, not suggest that settlements are illegal or even illegitimate, but are unhelpful to the peace process. They appear to be, I think, tacking back probably to the Bush administration's policy of essentially, you know, wink, wink, nod, nod to the Israelis. You can build in the existing blocks that are likely to be part of Israel in any future agreement, but why don't you calm down on the rest of the stuff? So all of that, I think, is kind of a turn back towards some degree of bipartisan consensus. And I also say that while Kushner, the Secretary of Everything, is ostensibly in charge of Middle East peace, it's actually Jason Greenblatt, the chief negotiator at the White House, who's in charge of this day to day, and he's doing a great job, an amazing job, actually, as far as I can tell. So that's the good news. The bad news is, events on the ground, even if you don't have a settler movement going hog wild to establish a greater Israel in the near term, you're getting a creeping towards that outcome. I mean, within the course of this, the first term of this administration or two terms of a Trump administration, if they don't come to some resolution here, the possibility of a two-state outcome will be non-viable economically, politically, and everything else. So that's my wrap-up comment, which is, you know, you have a president who actually doesn't express a lot of interest in being engaged with the world other than periodic uses of American military power. And that in the absence of leadership that's more comprehensive than just using the military instrument, a lot of things are going to happen and that we won't have a say in, and that the world will be shaped by others. And it's not in our interest to have the world shaped by others, whether it's in the Middle East or Asia or anywhere else. And that, you know, Obama got criticized for not using the military instrument enough, but he understood that American engagement meant comprehensive engagement, and it was as much about our diplomacy, our engagements with civil society, and our economic policy as it was with how many countries we were bombing on any given day.
I will go back to the gentleman's question on counterinsurgency, which we didn't get to, and Afghanistan. The only thing I can say to that is, like so much else, we don't know. We haven't seen anything from the administration. And I don't say that pejoratively. It's a big world. There's lots of problems. It's only been 197 days. And, you know, that is an area of that we spent quite a bit of time on to figure out where our strategy would be in the second term. And today, there are 9,800 Americans working very hard, both on the counterterrorism mission and to help build the Afghanistan security forces. And another, say, 5,000 in NATO partners who are also working alongside us. So the question is, what way is the Trump administration going to go on this? And importantly, are they going to take steps to keep partners on board, right? The NATO partners have been critical in terms of the ISAF forces there. that, like so much else, is a place that cries out for working in partnership, particularly on the counterterrorism side of the mission. So I'll now pivot to the values question, which is, and it links back to the transparency piece that we talked about before. I think the fundamental question here is the Trump administration going to engage in the world in a way that is driven by and rooted in partnerships with our allies, with other partners around the world, whether it's in Afghanistan or other places? And to do that, you need to have credibility, and you need to have legitimacy, and in the actions that you undertake. And so, you know, we have this debate about transparency. We would have those debates in the Situation Room a lot. You know, well, is it in our national security interest to be this transparent about X or Y? The truth of the matter is, you're never going to satisfy the transparency people 100% of the time, and there will always be national security equities on the other side of the ledger. So one of the things President Obama used to talk about is leading with our values. One of those values is being transparent about what we're doing, particularly in the counterterrorism space, as much as we can. And my own view on this is we should be leading with our values. One of them should be transparency, but not for transparency's sake and not for our values' sake per se, but because it's the only way we can maintain legitimacy of our actions, both with our partners abroad and, quite importantly, I would argue, with the American people. Because if they are not with you, whether you're bombing in a foreign land, whether you're engaging in covert action, whether you're engaging in tough diplomacy, you need the support of the American people. And for that, you need credibility and you need legitimacy. And that comes from leading with your values.
David.
I'm inclined to just let that be the last word, but I won't.
Look, see, it's just like being back in the situation.
No, I think it is well understood that our national security is enhanced in immeasurable ways, but in very real ways, by the idea of America in the world. So in a macro sense, it reduces the number of people who grow up wanting to kill us. That's a good thing. It increases the willingness of countries, whether they're our allies or straddlers, to want to work with us in trying to solve problems around the world, to be our partners, and to bear some of the burden, frankly, of a complicated and dangerous world. But I just want to cite one sort of micro aspect of this that has real impact. And that is, so coming from my former employer, we recruit spies all around the world. And one of the most effective ways to recruit a spy is to find someone who is enamored with America, who thinks we stand for justice, for fairness, for opportunity, for doing the right thing, and who, as a result, is willing to betray his or her home country to share secrets with us. Those secrets that we collect around the world enhance our security every single day in enormously important ways. The more that we tarnish the coin of our realm, the more that we make the idea of America no longer attractive, the harder it's going to be for us to recruit people to work for us. And the harder it is for us to recruit people to work for us, the harder it's going to be for us to defend this country. And so, you know, you can talk about these big macro issues about getting countries to work with us and all the rest, but in ways that you cannot identify on a, you know, day-by-day basis, the more that we no longer are viewed in the world as being open, being fair, being the land of opportunity, where truth matters, the harder it will be for us to defend this country.
Please join me in thanking our wonderful panelists.